Okay, we're now going Facebook Live. And this is the artist meet and greet of the In Time of Protest exhibition being held here at the Get Box Gallery. And I have the pleasure to be with some of the wonderful artists and photographers that have been following the Black Lives Matters protest, each individually and sometimes even as a group. And they are showing their work, and it will be on display until August 1st at the Box Gallery located at 811 Belvedere Road. We are open to the public from 12 o'clock to 4 p.m. every day, and or by appointment. If those hours are inconvenient for you, you could always call 786-521-1199 and we could set up an appointment for you to see the show. Also, remember to visit us at www.theboxgallery.org for more information about the show and details of upcoming events. With that, I have the pleasure of introducing our first photographer that has been joining us on Facebook and is excited to be with us, Kevin Yangtunen.
Close. There you go.
Third time. I got to remember it.
Yeah, so no one can pronounce it right. No one can. I'm good. How you doing? I'm sorry?
How are you doing today?
I'm great. Thanks for asking. Yeah, I'm excited to be showcasing my images, excited to be part of the gallery, and I want to be sharing this as much as I possibly can because I think that's the most important thing to be doing with media and art during these times.
Can you tell us a little bit about what brought you into the foray of taking pictures at the protest? How did you get involved in the protest?
Well, I saw that the community was coming up and speaking for something important, and I wanted to do whatever I could do to be impactful and use my art, use my photography for something that was going to be bigger than myself and hopefully have an impact for the community, and came down as soon as I could, and I've been photographing everyone since June 6th.
Okay, next we have Miss Nelson, young dancer. If you could take yourself off of mute and let us know a little bit about how did a young dancer end up in the middle of a protest taking photographs?
Yeah, so my first art form or my home is definitely dance. I've been training here since I was 3 years old at local studios in Palm Beach County. But last summer, just as a hobby, I invested in and picked up a camera and just been casually like shooting my friends, using it as like another creative outlet. But while I was at home and there were protests happening, I just wanted to be a part of, you know, archiving something that was happening in my community, and really just like simply just like archive the history that was happening in Palm Beach County, and have something for myself, photos for myself, just to, you know, say that I was there, say that I was part of it, that my family was a part of it. And, you know, just wanted to be a part of a movement that is much larger than myself. So I'm very grateful for the opportunity to showcase them at the exhibit. That was not my intention at all, or not even something that I thought would happen. I was just, you know, going out to the protest, and I just wanted to be, you know, another person that's documenting history and, you know, keeping an archive of what's happening. So I'm really thankful to you for giving me the opportunity to showcase it and, even take this hobby into a different level and share it. And I've learned so much from this experience. So I'm very thankful for you. But yeah, I just think, as Kevin stated before, just to be a part of something much larger than me, and, you know, social media and it's so important right now, and just having those digital images that can spread, even though they're in a gallery right now, and that's equally as important. Having them on display is equally as important as having digitals that can, you know, be posted and go viral and just spread a message and awareness and emotion behind the movement. So I think that's very important.
All righty. Next, we have somebody that pretty much doesn't need an introduction because everybody knows him. He's been at almost every protest. He's been right in the middle of it, and he's gone to a lot of commission meetings, citizens meetings, reformers meetings. He's been right there along with a couple of other people that are in the show also. Zach Smith, tell us a little bit about how you're doing today.
I'm good. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate you guys giving me the opportunity to talk and share my photos and kind of keep the conversation alive. So I guess I'll answer the question as to why I decided to go out and start to photograph the protests. And the answer is similar to the previous two answers. I just felt that I needed to get out and document history. And then when I started to see how things were so peaceful and how West Palm Beach was really like doing things properly and doing things the right way, I thought that everyone needed to see it. So that's why I continued to go out there and share my posts readily on my Facebook and all over my other social media so people could get out there and see, or not get out there, but people can see via social media what we were doing on the streets and that we weren't rioting and we were actually constructively protesting. And photography is a way to kind of nip everything in the bud, anything that anyone may think negatively about it, because the proof is in the photos. And through the photos that I took, I believe that I portrayed everything, you know, the way that it really happened, which was all peacefully. So I really appreciate that. And I can confidently say that if things didn't stay as peaceful as they were, I probably wouldn't have been out there as long as I was. So as long as things continue to be peaceful and things continue to advance and move forward, you'll find me out at the protests. So it's really an incredible thing to be a part of.
Well, thank you, Zach. Now we have a trio. we have Joey Melendez, Mr. Brooks there, and Miss Davis from Brooks and Davis Photography. You guys were recording video. You guys were taking photographs. You were in the rain. You got a dynamite photograph. I know that Reese also was in the rain. And it was a crazy day, the day I got to meet you, because I was out there, and I'm too old to be in the rain, so I did. So I really enjoyed the fact that you guys stuck it out and brought home pictures of touching moments from the food distribution, which that's when I left, when the food was being distributed, and you guys ended up with magnificent photos. So one by one, introduce yourselves and let us hear from you.
All right, I'm Nicholas Brooks. I've been doing photography for as long as I can remember. And I got into the whole Black Lives Matter, documenting the movement, because as everyone said, it just felt like the right thing to do. We weren't really planning on doing anything with the photos. We just wanted to get out and capture the moment. For me, it was a little bit more therapeutic and like healing. And they were right there by my side. You know, we are a trio, as you mentioned, so it's always kind of like a package thing.
Hi, I'm Brittany. So much like what Nick was saying is that like when this all started, because we did go to the first one that was happening down in West Palm Beach the first night that it happened, and we just kind of called each other up and we're like, hey, like, this thing is happening, we should go document it. And we didn't, like you said, we didn't really have any ulterior motive behind it. We didn't know that we were gonna do anything with it. It's amazing that you reached out to us and gave us the opportunity to have somewhere to display it and really have the public be able to interact with it as well. And so for me, it was much more of a way that I could, it was more a way that, you know, I could be an ally to the movement and really help move the movement forward. And that's by doing photography. I've been doing photography for over 7 years now. And this is definitely like a lot different. Street photography, documentary photography is a lot different than what I'm used to. So it was a really cool experience to be part of a community who is trying to work toward one goal, and there's still a lot of work to be done, but we're just very grateful to be a part of the experience.
Hi, I'm Joey Melendez. I am kind of the third wheel in this. We're so used to collaborating and working together as a team. And it's kind of, that's how we feel, especially I could speak up for the three of us. We feel that is what artists do best is, you know, collaborate and work together. That's when you see the best outcome. So like Brittany was saying, one day we were just like working on different projects at home and we found out a protest was happening and we're like, you know, let's go check this out. Let's go do this. And I have to say one of the greatest experiences has been each protest that we've attended has been different. No protest was alike. You know, we had protests where people were involved in marches, in the food trucks. We've had, like you said, the food distribution. We've had a lot of different experiences in all of the different protests. And it was really nice to capture that. And just, you get a sense of community within itself being out there, being involved in the movement, especially because how actively we work together, we wanted something, how can I say it? We wanted something to experience together that really led the movement.
Awesome. Reese Blank. Blanke? You're eating. You just got plastered all over Facebook with a full mouth.
I have been going nonstop, and this is the first opportunity I've had to eat. But I was listening, I assure you.
So I remember that we have a common friend, Camilla, and I was planning on going and I didn't know that you were going. We had just finished working on a project and she calls me, she goes, oh my god, he's going there. And I was like, calm down, it's okay, I'll call him, you know. And it was so wonderful to see you out there on Rosemary Square. And that was a beautiful night, afternoon, and it ended up a little bit challenging. You were there for most of the day, right?
Yeah, I would say that, you know, from the gathering point at Rosemary Square through to at least, you know, the image that is behind me is it's cropped in, but it's a tiny earth of Meyer Amphitheater. This is where a lot of people ended up, and it was a great opportunity for people to use it as a literal platform, you know, to share their stories, to, you know, speak their truths, to, you know, kind of speak against what is being, you know, like the pop platitudes and sound bites that you hear about the movement and, you know, the individuals there within. It's funny that you mentioned that connection, because when I was getting text messages from people like, oh, you're going this, that, and the third, I'm from Portland, Oregon. So, yeah, like we boogie down major in Portland. I actually went out there in the, not the first time, but after I went out the first time, the next time I went out, it was in the capacity of offering medic services to people, because in Oregon, we're used to going out there and protesting for just about anything, any sort of social injustice. So, and not to say that it hasn't happened in West Palm before, but certainly not to this degree. So, you know, like making sure that people were properly hydrated, you know, or that they felt safe, you know, putting my body between the protesters and the police line, you know, and, you know, kind of, that was the main reason why. Not the main reason. That was the main capacity, rather, as to why I went. Not necessarily in regards to photography. I'm just my natural state, I guess, is to document things. In my current job, I do great contributions to society, right? I shoot secondary market crap for an auction house and try to make it look pretty. So that was the, kind of the other side of the coin of like, you know, I'm so tired of capitulating to a system that is designed to oppress us as a whole, and then furthering, you know, the oppression that has been felt by, you know, Black and brown bodies throughout history, and then just the blatant in your face, I think the age of capturing, you know, Gambino says it best, you know, like, cell phone, Sally's a tool, you know, everybody, you know, whenever you see something, everybody has their phones out. And I think that, you know, being able to put a spotlight on the injustices are bringing all these people together, right? So now you have these people out here, and, you know, in the news you read, or you see the comments on Facebook drive me up the wall. These protesters are out here. You know, you can't call them protesters. They're all out here rioting. And they all show the same photo of, you know, one broken window, or, you know, one person spray painted, you know, ACAB or 1312 or whatever, you know, on a piece of property. And, you know, what they're saying is that, you know, they value property and the status quo over the right for us to say that Black lives matter, not more, just matter. You know, like, I keep seeing this thing that, you know, equality is not pie. Just because other people gain equality doesn't mean that you lose rights. You know, so I think that being able to bring a perspective of a peaceful protest to the conversation, the social media conversation, you know, the, we're just inundated. You know, at least it's, you know, it's something that's showing that we are out here with purpose and resolve, and that is going to drive home, you know, I think a good amount of change. I hope that, you know, I hope that we can turn the tide towards socialism and not barbarism, not to bring it to like a, to that, but I guess just more so where we can see social justice instead of it just, you know, a shout in the wind. I don't think that that's the case anymore. I think it's building momentum, and throughout history we've seen that, you know, movements take time. You know, you can't, you know, the Occupy movement, if you will, petered out, and, you know, I hope that that doesn't happen here. And so long as we continue to document it, I don't think it will. So I give you all kudos, and all of the people who are not shown in a gallery, who are just out there and are saying, hey, this is what I see, this is my perspective, you know. And I think that now that we're able to share it, I hope that we're able to come together and, you know, kind of see firsthand accounts instead of taking the word of, you know, your friend's uncle. You know, like their opinion is worth something. It's not that it's worthless, but, you know, there are other opinions, there are other viewpoints. And Rolando, you know, you bringing it together for us, for the community, you know, the arts have always survived, and it's because of people like you and our comrades who have ensured that we've, you know, had our imaginations and inner selves heard and seen. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Which, you are the segue, actually, because you're the last person that I saw at 5:30, the day of the first protest, which was at Rosemary Square, which was wonderfully peaceful. I kept running up ahead of you so I could get pictures of you, and you were a lot faster than me, and a lot younger. So it was quite a workout for me. But I left at 5 o'clock, more or less. I think you left a little bit later. And then our friend Saragossa, who is, I don't know if he's back online, if he could turn on his screen, if he is. Hello.
Hello.
Jose Jesus.
Hello, ¿cómo estás?
Muy bien. You have the document of what was at one point an extremely peaceful and unity building gathering. Basically, it was a march, it was a protest, but more than anything else, it was a wonderful gathering that was calling just for support and unity. And it turned a little different towards the evening when it got a little darker. And you were there on the front lines with your video camera, with your iPhone of all things, that made the news that evening and created a contentious situation in West Palm Beach, which is now in the process of being resolved. So can you tell us a little bit about what you felt that moment?
Yeah, unlike everyone else who made, I guess, a conscious decision to go out there and cover the protest, I was out there almost by accident. Being a journalist of six... control the traffic and was able to do that and started power spraying. Me and pepper sprayed me as well. I have made my career off of presenting information unbiasedly and letting people make their own determination about what's happening. And that's, I think, what I'm doing here as well.
Okay. You're coming in and out. Your mic is turned off. Your mic is turned off. There you go.
Okay. All right. How much of that did you catch?
Very little.
Okay. So I said, I was on there by accident. I captured the moments the police officer pepper sprayed into the crowd. She actually pepper sprayed me too as I was filming. And what I was saying is that in my career, I've always presented the information and allowed other people to make their own determinations. And I think that's what I'd like for this to accomplish as well. People who watch the video will make their own decision about whether the protesters were wrong or the police were wrong. You know, it's just a video without any narration or any extra commentary. So...
And one of the gentlemen who is not part of this show will be, we're helping him for the closing reception. We've invited him to join us because I wasn't able to get his contact information. Max Maldonado, how you doing? Welcome.
Hi, how you doing, Rolando?
You were feeling too good this week and that you weren't able to get out the... and about so much, but you have not missed a single thing. You seem to, every time I turn around, you and Zach and Kevin are like fixtures in this whole movement.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I missed out on the first very big one, so I wanted to make sure I never missed out on another one after that.
So what enticed you to get involved in the whole Black Lives Matter protest and start documenting it?
Well, the thing that got me initially interested was just the same as everybody else is echoing, you know, that they wanted to keep a conversation going, that, you know, it's to bring to light the social injustices that a lot of the Black and African American communities face. And, you know, I wanted to help be the guy with the camera on the ground, you know, trying to contribute photos to either to any like social leader that I come across. I'm also a freelance journalist, so my job is to document, and I wanted, and like, what better opportunity to document than such a historic moment in history? So that's why I've been very boots on the ground, very running around all over the place, throwing my camera into the fray and just shooting as much as I can on while I could. So that's about the gist of everything.
Well, I am looking forward to showcasing at least one photograph. I was at the commission meeting, and you had a mask on. I had a mask on, so I didn't recognize you. I didn't know who you were, but you ran ahead of me. I was sitting in the front waiting for the photograph, and I couldn't get it because she had her head down, and she had her head down, and I was waiting, and I didn't want to. I wanted it to be natural. And when she lifted her head up, I didn't notice. I had gone back to my seat, and there you were taking the money shot of the girl with the Unity sign.
Oh, yeah.
That was one of my favorite shots. I think that Unity shot has been gotten around. I think every one of the photographers and the artists who were out there, photojournalists, have taken a photograph of that sign, which is the basically the foundation of what my experience is. And I really wanted to get that shot, but you got it, and I'm so happy. And I am gonna post it up on my page because that is one of the most powerful images that I have seen with the whole Unity. And I may even do a little video with everybody's photographs of that Unity sign. If I have everybody's permission.
And my permission.
And okay, so we have, let's see, nobody else is in the show right now. So let's go back around and start from the beginning. Kevin, would you like to share a couple of images from your screen and tell us a little bit about the actual photograph and when it was taken and what was going on in your head as you were experiencing this?
Yeah, I'd love to. I'd love to show some images. I'm gonna be showing some exclusive images too. You guys are getting a real sneak peek on these. Some of these aren't showing in the gallery, but you know, I feel that they're important to show. So can everyone see this image that I have pulled up?
Yes.
Cool. So this, of course, is of the mural outside Respectable Street. And in the foreground is the damage from a rubber bullet that the police have fired in. This was taken shortly after Chalk the Block, which was June 23rd, I believe. And here is Mr. Michael Lopez. I'm sure you guys have seen his sign. He painted that himself. But I snapped this photo because I wanted to have the kind of this like juxtaposition between this sign showing the solidarity that the community has, the sign that everyone chalked with their own art, their own messages. And in the foreground is this kind of destructive remnant that the police have left. You know, this kind of broken window, you know? It's kind of interesting to say, you know, a little contrast between like broken window policing, an actual broken window, and this kind of unity that the community has shown. So
this is a storefront window.
Yeah, this is. This is,
storefront windows are generally a little bit tougher than the average home window, right?
Absolutely. I talked to the business owner and he's saying that it's impact glass. And he was saying he kind of looks at it as like a badge of honor, something to remind him that the fight is still going. And I'd like to think that the community also can look at this destruction and turn it in a positive light and help them remember that, hey, you know, we're holding it down here and this broken glass, it's not going to scare us.
You mentioned that it was a rubber bullet. But that doesn't seem like a rubber bullet that's made out of rubber that bounces.
It looks pretty powerful, doesn't it?
Yeah.
That's hurricane grade.
I can only imagine if that would hit a person.
Unfortunately, we see too many videos of that. I've been seeing far too many videos. Far too many just people getting hit with rubber bullets. And yeah, it's incredibly destructive. As you can see right here, this is completely shattered impact hurricane grade glass. And I'm just going off what the business owner said. You know, he believes that it was a rubber bullet. It's entirely possible it was a tear gas canister. It's entirely possible it was a beanbag round. But
okay,
you know, it's quite an impactful vision, I'd say. This contrast between the two elements, and then of course Mr. Mikey Lopez, good friend of mine, artist.
Okay, let's see another image, a couple of other images.
Sure. And first and foremost, I feel like I really got to thank Wedmeyer. This is Mr. Wedmeyer Pierre. He's been leading all the protests, and Trayvon in the background. Wedmeyer, obviously, as you all know, you've all met Wedmeyer. You all know Wedmeyer, and he's been critical. And he's forming the Reformers movement right now with some other friends of his, Jessica, Mr. Corey, Nearing Jr. He's been an incredible force in that, and you know, he's really got it. He's got the leadership capability, and you know, I just got to give a shout out to him and make sure, you know, he gets represented too, and he gets all these photos, and I make sure, of course, I share all the photos to him and everybody.
And he's got his Pam Keith mask on.
Absolutely, yeah, Pam Keith. She's running for U.S. Congress, and she's been speaking at some of the protests. She's a great driving force too, and it's everyone vote.
Are there all right. Other people that have been showing up is actually Councilman
Guido Weiss
himself, mm-hmm. Candidate Guido Weiss. The Indivisibles have shown up, and I believe Alex Friedman showed up at one of them also. So big round of applause to all our committed leaders in the community for showing
Absolutely. up. So yeah, that's Wedmeyer right there, and this is Mr. Bryce, Prophet Bryce, and he also incredible orator, incredible force, and he has personally told me that this image right here, this is one of the most, I didn't know what to say after he told me this. He told me that this image, he bought a print of it. He said that this reminds him why he continues to fight in this cause. And that right there is the reason, one of the main reasons that I want to be contributing my photography. If it makes an impact, if it touches people, if they can see something in it that immortalizes a moment, you know, otherwise ephemeral moment, that they can continuously see that everyone's speaking, they're heard, they're seen, they're felt. And I feel like this right here, Bryce showing his passion, incredible orator, showing his passion and speaking to everybody for something he truly believes in and something we should all believe in and fight for. Okay. I thought this was an important moment right here.
Yeah, Kevin, we're going to move along and give Zach Smith an opportunity to show us a couple of his photographs next. Sure. And Absolutely. Tell us a little bit about it, and then we'll come right back to you. And we'll keep cycling this way so that our Facebook audience enjoys a little bit about everybody's work and gets to hear the artists as they tune into Facebook and tune out, because we have people coming in and out all the time. Zach, Definitely. Would you like to show us a couple of your images and talk about your relationship to the image and the people in the photographs?
Sure. So this is the first photo that I want to show you guys. And I'm kind of going to try to go in chronological order just to kind of show you guys how everything played out throughout the weeks and months eventually. So this was actually from the first night of protests when everything broke out into craziness. This was actually a couple hours, about an hour after everyone got off of 95 when they shut down 95. And I unfortunately was not with the group when they shut down 95, but I joined when the group basically got to Rosemary Square. And then half the group decided to stay in downtown West Palm Beach. And another small portion of the group decided to walk over the bridge to Palm Beach Island and eventually, I guess, continue to Mar-a-Lago. But at that point, everyone was so exhausted and tired, and the walk was so long from downtown West Palm to Mar-a-Lago that it was really, really tough. And as you can see, the sweat in this picture, everyone was just extremely, extremely exhausted. But I took this photo about probably like 2/10 of a mile north of Mar-a-Lago. And we were just walking, minding our own business. And all of a sudden we were met with this line of sheriffs and police officers and SWAT trucks and this and that, and so much excessive force. And that was the first time that I'd ever seen anything like that. It scared the hell out of me, to be honest with you. But I knew that we weren't doing anything wrong. We weren't breaking any laws. We weren't being destructive. And if anything, we were being more quiet and more peaceful than the police officers were being. And if we would have been able to just continue protesting, the residents of Palm Beach Island most likely would not have even known that we were outside their house. But because of all this with the loudspeakers and the helicopters overhead and this and that, it became such a big scene. But this picture kind of depicts the peacefulness that the crowd showed towards police officers. And there was really no sort of violence or anything like that. And I thought that was really important to show. Next photo is of a young woman, is Alyssa, and I've actually gotten to know her pretty well throughout these past couple weeks and month, as well as a lot of my subjects that I've taken photos of. It's became really personal to me. So this is one of my favorite photos that I took out of all the protests. It's of Alyssa, and you can just see the passion in her face and her chanting and cheering, and you have the police lights in the background that are kind of reflecting off the ground from the rain. And you have the Black Lives Matter sign in the background. And of course, she's wearing the Pulse shirt, which was really important to me. So I feel like this kind of encapsulates a lot of the issues that have been going on in Florida in the past few years, and also shows the passion of the people here in West Palm Beach.
Your picture, you have a photograph. Well, this is one of the photographs that lead on one of the videos, as well as you have another photograph that made the West Palm Beach magazine this month. Do you have that one handy to show everybody? Tell us a little bit about this one though first.
So this one was at the end of a protest. This is actually on Clematis Street. This was, if I'm not mistaken, the only protest that actually got stopped by police force on Clematis Street. And it was right after they actually arrested one of the protesters, and the entire group of people was chanting for him to be let go. And they were saying that they wouldn't leave until the protester was let go. And it was just another great sense of unity that I thought was really, really moving. And you can kind of see here, there's two people holding up the Black Lives Matter signs and a police car shining its spotlight at them. And then on the very far right of the photo, you have the gentleman holding his phone, showing what's going on Facebook Live, which is such a tall tale sign to the times and how everything is always recorded and things like that. And Rolando, I don't have the photo on hand. I can show it in a little bit. Is it the photo you're referring to is with the megaphone?
Yes.
Yeah, so that is...
While you look for that, we're going to ask Ms. Nelson to share the photos that she shows at the gallery and tell us a little bit about what you wrote to me and why the difference and why you put the photographs together in color as well as in black and white. Because that speaks to the larger name of the exhibition is the aesthetics of politics in the time of protest. And it was shortened for marketing reasons to in the time of protest. But yours really captures the crux of and the theme of the exhibition. So can you share a little bit about that?
Sure. Okay. So this picture it's on display in the exhibit in color and in black and white. And originally I sent them both. I sent you two reasons as to why I wanted to show them in color and in black and white. And the first one was mainly because, at least the way I was taught about the civil rights movement in my history classes, or even I feel the way that it's presented now, it presented in a way that makes it seem like it was so long ago. But in reality, when you look at the pictures of the people that are fighting and are in the protest, they're still around, they're still living and breathing, and some of them are people's grandparents and great grandparents. So I wanted to have the black and white parallel to show that we are still fighting for the same thing. So even though it may seem like so long ago in this, you know, black and white, you know, other decade, century, we're still fighting for those same things now. So I wanted to like create those parallels by having those pictures side by side. And also just for the people that are, you know, in these pictures and the people that are even not depicted and are protesting or being allies or just a part of the movement in any way that they can, for them to, you know, have a symbol, for them to show that they are a part of history, and that one day, like even this picture that is taken in color, for the next generation, our grandkids, that picture will, that will be their version of black and white, and we will still be fighting for the same thing. And, you know, we will still be trying to say the same message that Black Lives Matter, equality, equity, justice, will all still be fighting for the same thing. So I just wanted to create those parallels by having them in black and white and in color.
Well, thank you. Do you have the black and white version of it to show everybody?
Yes. Let's see. So here's the black and white version. And I also, this one is one of my favorites because obviously George Floyd's death and murder is why this whole movement was started. And this painting is really just beautiful of him saying, "I can't breathe." And how many times have we heard a black man's last words be, "I can't breathe." But for the black women, I also just want to point out that this sign of why are Breonna Taylor's murder still free? It's been over 120 days and those officers still have not been arrested. Only one has been fired. And Breonna Taylor and so many other people's death were not recorded and caught on film or, you know, caught on tape, posted on Instagram. It did not go viral, but she was still murdered and her life still mattered. And I just, you know, that picture, this sign stands out to me almost more than anything, because George Floyd's death is why we were all brought to this movement, but we're still fighting for Breonna Taylor even today and all those other names of people who whose deaths were not caught on film. So that is really important for me in this photograph.
Out of curiosity, would you like to tell everybody how old you are?
I'm 21.
Okay, and you know what? This movement has brought forth a generation of 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22-year-olds that are engaged.
Even little kids.
Yeah, that are seriously engaged. And you know what you want. You know what you're experiencing. And there's a call, you know, for, you know, some justice that has not been seen before. And I really need to commend all of you, not just the artists, but all of the protesters. And among them, I know we have a couple of people that are organizers on the Zoom, and we may give them a little moment after to talk a little bit. But we're going to move along to Nicholas Brooks now, and with Brittany Davis and Joey Menendez, who are going to be doing tripling up on some of the images that they took, edited it together, and presented.
Hey, guys. Okay. So this was actually the first day. The second day. The second day of protests.
Well, it was the second one that I went to. So this one was taken at the protest where we marched from the courthouse to Southern Boulevard Bridge on 95. And along the way, like going to, this was where we met at the bridge where there were already police officers blocking the on-ramp. And so there's a big, to the left, there's a big group of protesters. And then to the right, there's the officers. What I absolutely love about this shot is that like this one just captivates me for so many different reasons. Just even the fact that really other than the person who's in the middle, there's no full faces really being shown. You can see the officers on one side, you can see the protesters and the raw emotion on the other side. You know, the mask, the shirt that reads, "I can't breathe." You know, the fact that he's not looking directly at the camera, it is a very candid moment. There's a lot of emotion, and there's just a lot of raw feeling that goes into it. So this photograph is personally one of my favorites from the ones that I've attended, just because of that rawness. And then next one, next.
Okay, so for me, like I said, there was this therapeutic feeling that I got like in attending the other protest. This was on Juneteenth, and this was during the 8 minutes and 46 seconds of silence for George Floyd. And I love this image because I mean, honestly, I actually risked my camera for this one. I didn't have like any protective like gear for the camera, so it was just pouring, and I felt like when the shot was taken, it was, the rain just kept coming down like harder and harder, and I just love this sign that says this is what love looks like, because it actually felt like every time I look back at this photo, I feel the love and I feel just the moment, you know. This was pretty good. And then in the midst of it, there was Ricky Aiken. And this, I felt like it captured the way that he speaks and like kind of captures the crowd. Another image that I really enjoy is this one, the white silence is white violence. In the moment, I thought that, you know, she just captured my attention, and I loved her look. Just the aesthetic of this was really just radiating, and it was really cool because of this gallery. I actually got to make a connection and find out her name. Her name's Maya, and you know, we've connected on like Facebook and Instagram since, and it's just again part of the therapeutic process, and the community building that this whole experience has brought. And then, Joey, you want to take on?
Okay.
I had the pleasure of meeting Maya over at the gallery. She came one evening and saw the show, and we got to chat a little bit. Wonderful, wonderful lady.
Yeah.
She was so sweet. She was so sweet.
And
then now we're going to go ahead and show a preview of Joey's piece.
So, so for my piece, the video aspect, I know that a lot of people haven't had the opportunity to necessarily go out into the protest and witness it for themselves, whether because of COVID or any other circumstances that prevented them from being able to witness it in person. So part of the installation piece at the gallery includes an 8 minute and 46 second video. And for the purpose of this artist forum, I did condense it down to just a few snippets. It's about a minute long, just so you can kind of see what it was like through our eyes live.
If you say nothing, you are an accessory to violence. Let these words for the tears of our people that are crying. We can bring back hope, but not the people that are dying. It's what happens when the people you repress ask for change in the country that they built, but you ignored and denied. George Floyd and every single family, police brutality is intervened in and destroyed. Couple bad cops can't define all you other boys. So every good cop needs to stand up and make some noise. Black, white, Asian, doesn't matter because we can't avoid. So let's all come together, join hands, and just get annoyed at people who believe racism makes sense in a country built on minorities. Slave, work, employee, nobody's born racist, man. It's something you learn deep rooted in your brain from the day of your birth.
I told them I was American.
Repair all of these bridges we burn and let love out of to the cheeks we turn. Spread love, show love. Let's get rid of this curse. Don't wait for anyone to act. Man, you go first. 400 years wasted. Let's get rid of this hurt, because that's the only way we'll ever see peace on earth.
I can't breathe. I can't breathe.
Wow, that one image of everybody walking in the rain arm in arm is so powerful to watch all the different colors of the races all lined up arm in arm walking, trudging the road to justice together. That's amazing.
Yeah. It was exactly like I had said. Every single protest we've attended from Coral Springs all the way to West Palm has truly been unique and different in just the sense of community and the sense of seeing people come together. And exactly like the one image of like, this is what love looks like.
Thank you. Max, are you ready to show us a few highlights? I hope you have that unity picture because I'm dying to see it again.
Yeah, I did. I just found it in my, you know, my archive. So let me pull up my screen real quick. All right. So you wanted to see this one? Is this the one that you're talking about, Rolando?
Yes.
yeah, that was shot on June 29th during the commissioner's meeting, as you said. As a photographer, like you, I like to be very much in the background. I like to be very much like fly on the wall. I don't like to be noticed very much and to have people look down my lens, because it sometimes takes away from the photo, but in this circumstance it added to it, because she had been the first time, like I think that you might have seen this one. There's a lot of head down and everything like that, but as soon as she popped her head up, that was definitely the one that made the image.
Can you click on it so we could see it a little better, bigger?
Sorry about that. Sorry, it's just that the photo viewing app that I use is not as good as the ones that you guys are using, unfortunately. Sorry.
It's okay.
sorry about that. To get to some of my other works. This was during the June 6th. Sorry about that. Choked a little bit. This is during June 6th. This is a moment where I call it intermission. Everybody just broke out into dance. Everybody just started. The movement really became like one at that point. Everybody was chanting. Everybody was joining together in this one moment of cohesion that I thought was pretty amazing. And thankfully, I was just in the right place at the right time to just get down and just to see that beautiful arc of movement that they were creating when they were starting to dance. That was a very special moment I felt in the during the June 6th protests.
So we're going to right now, I'm going to put up a couple of images that made the press actually.
Mm. Okay, so.
Let's see. Can you close your screen?
Yes, of course. There you are.
And this just came out today. And it is the arts and entertainment page of the Fort Myers, Florida Weekly. And I'd like to congratulate Saul Martinez for this wonderful image that made the paper. We also have this spread that appeared in West Palm Beach magazine. And that is, on the left is the picture, the photograph that Zach took. Up here is another one of Saul Martinez. Saul Martinez is a photojournalist that is pretty much the New York Times resident Florida photographer right now. So if you see anything, any articles that deal with Florida in the New York Times, you can almost guarantee that it was one of his photographs. And the bottom one was from the courthouse, and it's a photograph that I ended up taking, and it's of Windmeyer also. Windmeyer has become pretty much the face of the program, of the movement, I guess, because he was pretty much one of the originators of the protest. Although there have been a lot of leaders and a lot of speakers throughout the numerous events, and not only from the African-American or Black community, but from the allies that have spoken out in support. And it once again, it brings back to that, you know, it was a hashtag, and I had mentioned this in an article that I wrote, that it was a hashtag for Gay Pride this year, which said unity in the community. And then the COVID hashtag, which is we're in this together. And the new movement with the murder of George Floyd and bringing together all of the community under the banner of Black Lives Matter made those two hashtags really come to life, because there was an exemplified what unity in the community, the call for unity in the community, and it proved that we were all in this together. I have a young lady who's also not in the show, but she is organizing another project with me, and I hope she comes up. Jai, are you there? Hello. Okay, she might have stepped away for a moment. But when she comes back, she'll tell you a little bit about what we're planning on August 8th. There's a number of different events that will be going on. As you know, the main purpose of bringing all of this work into the galleries and into the theaters and into spoken word events is for people who have been staying at home, they have been getting this information through Zoom, to be able to, we get to take you to the front lines as best we can to experience the catharsis that people are having, the experiences, having them share. If you meet with any of these artists or any of the event people, sit down and talk to them. Not only are they the creative forces behind the image making and the amplification of the movement, but they are also the participants. And that's a wonderful thing that has come up. So I'm going to put Jai Allen a belt, which is, I want to say that she's like a little sister or a little niece to me, because I have a wonderful relationship with her mom for years. And I've known Jai since she was a little girl. And I'm amazed at how you're coming to terms with this and how elegantly you have organized and presented yourself. And the upcoming project that I'm looking forward to working with you. You got to turn yourself on. Your mic is off.
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. What am I saying? Did I miss that?
You're going to talk a little bit about what's going on.
Where do I even start? I mean, I'm 25 and I've been doing this since I was 23, and I'm so excited that the Black Lives Matter movement is popping off right now. It's been going off for a while now, and now that people are waking up and they're seeing that, like, now is the time to start unifying. We've been operating off of divide and conquer for so long, and now it's time to try united we stand. We've been trying you divide and conquer for years now, and it hasn't worked. So based on results, it hasn't worked. We've been hurting each other. And I am so passionate about us peacefully coexisting. And I don't have to like you, you don't have to like me. I don't have to believe what you believe, but as long as we can sit next to each other and walk down the street next to each other, that's what my mission is. So we have a project coming up in August 8th, where we're gonna be doing it at Boynton Beach Art District. And I'm the founder of a nonprofit organization called The Uproar Projects, where we are a team of activist artists and we promote normalizing peace rallies and through artistry. So I'm excited to see where that goes. And I love that protests are happening because it's a demonstration that we can coexist, and I don't want it to stop. And I've also, you know, peacefully protested with a few people and collaborated with Woodmire for freedom fighters for justice in recent protests. And I will continue to protest, but in the meantime, we will be also doing what we do for the uproar, which is promoting peace through artistry. And Kevin actually has a picture of us. Kevin and Max has been there because I've participated in Woodmire's protests. So he's, both of them have been there when I've given speeches speaking into unity. And, you know, African-Americans passing away for no reason and becoming nameless and it being too common and it being time for us to stop. So I love that Kevin is showing the pictures right now. I'm gonna stop so that he can even like, he can get the spotlight so we can show those pictures.
I think we're in a circle. So actually it's his turn again to talk about one of his pieces. Thank you, Jai. I love you. I love your mom.
Thank you.
You know that me and your mom did all this crazy stuff. Talked about gardens and building stuff and donating building beds and all this stuff for people that were in need and in crisis to make their lives a little better. Your mom is a wonderful teacher, not only in academics but in life. One of my dear mentors. And it's a pleasure to have you walk back into my world. I love you.
Love you too.
And that brings us back to Kevin. Kevin.
Hello. Hi.
Okay, talk to me a little bit about a couple of your other images.
Okay, cool. Let me pull it up. Share screen. Okay, I'll kick back where I left off just to... All right, looks like it's sharing. And this is Frankie Pierre Paul. He is the founder and CEO of A Different Shade of Love, and he is doing absolutely righteous work in helping the homeless community around Palm Beach County. And here he is during Juneteenth, leading a prayer, or rather concluding a prayer in this moment. I think this just really shows just that kind of benevolence that you got in the leaders of the movement. And Frankie Pierre Paul, man, he's just... honestly, one of the greatest dudes I ever met. Like this dude is incredible. He's awesome. He's got a good heart. And I feel like, you know, like just showing this kind of like joy and hope that he's got and praying for everything. You know, I wanted to make sure I capture this and showcase it. You know, check him out. Different Shade of Love. That's his org. All right. And Rain or Shine. I mean, you guys already know if you've been around during the Juneteenth protest and the vigil on July 3rd, which is when this was taken, everyone stayed. Everyone made sure, rain or shine, that we're going to keep doing this, keep speaking our voices. And here you can see it's just pouring rain. It's pouring rain. And this Bryce right here, total gentleman, holding the umbrella open. And everyone's just going to sit it out, wait it out. This was during a moment of silence for George Floyd, for Breonna Taylor, for everyone, Eric Garner, everyone who is... passed and been murdered by police in the country. And it was quite fitting. Doing a moment of silence, it just pours rain and no one's moving. We're all staying. I stayed. And I mean, like Nick said, you risk the camera, but you know, when it keeps raining, you know, you don't want to just kind of shy away and not represent that everyone's sticking around despite bad weather. And you know, here's Sarah. This is Sarah Stearns. This is her sign, the unity sign that's been, as like Rolando said, it's a staple. It's like, it's showcasing just the kind of, how galvanized we all are in making sure we want to have unity in the community. And it's pouring rain and still it shines. Still the idea of unity shines. So I thought this was, it's always important to take a picture of the unity sign. Always is. And I do feel like some of the police, they sympathize with what's going on. You can just see this kind of, you know, this emotion that you can't fake. Like you, and like Max said, I want to be the same kind of fly on the wall. I want to get the candid moments. I want to make sure I capture like emotional moments, moments that you can't really fake, completely candid. And it's just raining here and we're all marching, doing our thing. And I don't know, I just looked at his face as I passed him and he just had this look on his face, man. And I don't know, you know, got to always make sure that, you know, not all police are bad and everything. And you got to make sure that you represent that. There's some cops that you could see emotion in their eyes. You could see that they care, but, you know, it's terrible what's going on. Antonio, another incredible man. He is, I believe he's going to DC actually soon to join the protest going on. And, you know, this was shot on the 6th of June. We were bottlenecked by the police. Bottlenecked between two businesses right in the front, Congress Avenue, cops right here, and we're stuck between two buildings as we were trying to march through. And anything could have gone down, but, you know, he made sure to keep recording on Facebook Live, to keep letting everyone know that, hey, like, we're all together. And, you know, I just caught this moment right here, a tear rolling down his cheek, man. Like, these are the type of things that you got to always make sure, you know, like, this is felt, this is raw, this is real, and people are feeling it. And, you know, I want to make sure I capture these moments, these real moments that you know. I love this image. I love this one. And I can keep going, yeah, Rolando, if, unless you want me to.
I would like to, to keep circling around, and I'm
absolutely
going,
yeah.
We're going back to Zach. Zach, you have another couple of wonderful images. Of the 3,400 wonderful images that I got to enjoy privately, of which you've only shown, I guess, on Facebook and in the exhibition, you've only shown a select few. My gallery in my window, facing out, if you catch the pass by the gallery at 811 Belvedere and it happens to be closed, you will get to enjoy at least 100 pictures that are wonderfully placed on the front window facing out. For those of you who want to enjoy the show, want to visit the gallery, but do not want to go inside and you don't feel safe inside places, even with a mask on, we do have work on the windows for you to enjoy. And Zach, tell us a little bit about, you were trapped, and you showed a lot of stamina. I think you stayed put for 9 hours or something like that to gain access to the rest of the program. Tell us a little bit about that experience. And do you have photos from that evening?
I do. I have a couple photos from that evening. So I will start off by saying, kind of in contrast to Max and Kevin, I really like to get up close and personal with my subjects, especially if I get to know them personally. I kind of feel like it helps portray a story or whatever I'm trying to depict. And it doesn't work with everybody, but I'll show you guys a couple examples of kind of what I'm talking about. So the first one, this actually is not from the Wellington protest. This is from the protest that got shut down on the overpass of 95. And this is kind of the picture that I chose to use as my submission for my cover photo and everything that may get used for social media and stuff, because I really thought that this picture was a great call to action. It looks like he's talking to you, speaking to you, making sure that you hear what he's saying and that his voice doesn't fall on deaf ears. So that's kind of why I decided to take this picture. And I have a series of photographs that feature this gentleman in it. And it just seemed like every photograph that I took was more personal than the last. And it just so happened that way. And people started questioning how real some of the photos were, like if they were staged or anything. But I can promise you 100% that it was all genuine. And it just happened where I would know when he was getting excited and when he was starting to yell, and I would be right there in his face with the camera, and he loved it. So it's kind of interesting to see when people react a certain way with a camera in front of their face. And then next, let's see. I'm just gonna open these up.
While you're doing that, I want to thank everybody on Facebook that is watching on my Facebook page as well as on the Box Gallery. We encourage you to visit the Box Gallery on Facebook, on Instagram, so that you could stay updated as connected to all of these artists. You could follow them on the Box Gallery on Instagram. Most of them in the latest post, their names are listed under the most current image.
So this back. Thanks.
My mini commercial and plug all of you so that you guys get some followers on Instagram.
I love it. So this is a photo of a young woman named Jazzy Pitts, and I've gotten to know her throughout the protests pretty well. And this is a photo that I took in Wellington, which is the protest that Rolando was referring to, where we kind of got cornered. Our plan was to march about 2 miles, and we were told that we were allowed to by Palm Beach County Sheriff's Office and by the mayor of Wellington. And we started marching, and Palm Beach County Sheriff's Office decided to block our way to get to our final destination. So instead of letting us walk the mile and a half or 2 miles or whatever it was, they kept us on somebody's private property, basically on the sidewalk, for 9 hours. And wouldn't let us move, and basically just stood there and looked at us while we stood there and looked right back at them, because we knew that we weren't doing anything wrong, and they just were meeting us with excessive force. So this is Jazzy Pitts, and she's kind of yelling to the crowd, but this photo in particular is actually being displayed in the gallery, and it's one of my favorite photos that I took throughout the protests. And I'm actually collaborating with another artist who lives down south in Miami. And he's making a really, really awesome art project painting out of this photo. So definitely keep an eye out for that, because he told me it's gonna be done tomorrow. I was hoping it'd be done today, but he's been working on it for a long, long time, and it's really, really incredible. Another shot from Wellington is a photo of a gentleman walking through this overpass that we were all basically forced to walk through because we didn't want to be on the street or get arrested for being on the street. So we all walked through this metal overpass, and this guy emerged, and he has this sign that says racism is the pandemic. And I think that speaks volumes to the time period that we're in. Obviously there's a pandemic of COVID going on, but what is really the pandemic here? So that's why I took that photo. And lastly, we have, I think that's it from Wellington, but I just wanted to show you guys one more photo. This is my personal favorite photo that I took out of the group of protests that I was at. And it's of little Charlotte, who is become quite the celebrity in West Palm Beach. And she actually has an Instagram called the Social Justice Toddler. And her mom has taken her out to these protests pretty much from day one and kind of exposed her to all of this, which I find very admirable. But this picture, I think, just speaks volumes about hope and about our future and about what potentially can be brought to life with proper teachings and proper guidance to our youth. So that was an extremely important photo for me to take and also share. And that one is also on display at the gallery as well.
Well, thank you. And we're rotated all the way back to Ms. Nelson. How are you? You're sitting there so quiet. I got to hand it to you. You and your mom showed up at the gallery. Both of you are so, so humble, so sweet. I really enjoyed my time with you and your mom the other day.
Thank you so much. This picture that I'm gonna show kind of touches on what we just talked about. So I think the signs that we've all been seeing just have been not only creative but just really speak volumes to the times. So having the Black Lives Matter sign along with I Will Never Understand But I Stand With You really speaks to how this movement right now is so much different than the civil rights movement in the 50s and 60s, for the fact that internationally it's much bigger than it was in the 50s and 60s. And I just think the presence of non-Black allies have really just taken this movement to the next level, and that's what we all need. We all need everyone of all creeds and colors and beliefs to really just come together. And I think not only with the technology of, you know, having information spread instantly, but just really having people of all backgrounds show up and fight for equity is what is taking this level, this movement to the next level, and really making the conversation and the changes that need to happen. So I think it's really important to, for more people to say that I will never understand, but I will stand with you. And I think that that just says so much, that you don't have to believe what I believe. You don't have to agree with my policy, but my life should not be a threat to you. Our disagreement should not hinder me from taking a next breath, from taking a jog, from sleeping in my bed, from, you know, doing all these other things that the world has made seems that Black people cannot do. So I think that really speaks volumes, that more people just need to say that I may not understand, I may not agree, but I stand with you. And that's why I love this picture.
Thank you. You know that I'm really interested the dichotomy, the relationship between the ally community, and Black and brown, because this is more of a Black Lives Matter. Mm-hmm. And the voices that need to be amplified are those that have gone for too long unheard of. Yeah. And it is the Black voice. Yeah. And even as brown people or Asian or any other colors, it is not our voices necessarily, but our role to place ourselves as allies. In the long run, we all benefit from seeing justice served in one community. If it's established in the community where it's least had, it trickles down. Unlike trickle down economics, trickle down justice does work, because it creates case law that we can all benefit from later. So the important thing about the George Floyd thing right now, the case, is to keep an eye on it and to fight for the maximum sentence, because this particular case, since it has international awareness, is going to be used as a case law for what remedies can be done.
Yes.
And that I will never understand, but I stand with you. 5 or 6 years ago, I joined a group that was Artists for Black Lives Matters. And people were trying to explain what white fragility is, what it was like to be a mother, because most of the women that I was meeting with at the time, the artist over there was with Nikki Lopez and a couple other people from Broward. And among the many conversation was a Black Puerto Rican woman who said, "You have no idea. When I hug my son and send him to school, I hold him real, real tight because I want to feel his heartbeat, because it might be the last time I feel his heartbeat. And I live with that reality." And that's what you will never understand. Because many of you just send your kids to school and like, here's enough money for lunch. And you're worried that he might lose the money or she might lose the money. But in your being, it is not that sense of fear that comes with, I may never see him again.
Exactly.
I have this one that I can't show it to you. Let me see if I get it on the screen. I picked that up and it says, "You don't have to be Black to be outraged either." Which is something, I'm gonna turn my screen off because I don't know who made it, but I picked it up And I am going to put none so I could show it to you all. Does everybody see that?
Yes, I agree. You don't have to be Black. You just have to care about people. You just have to care about humanity.
And I love that sign. It was left on the lawn. And I left it there for a day. And then I went back. And then I was like, I got to keep it because that is our role, because we should all be outraged. It is a public murder done with any semblance of care, without any worry. The only concern that they had was move back so that we could finish killing him.
Right.
You know, and that was very obvious in the tape. So we're moving along. We're still at the Box Gallery, Meet the Artist for the Aesthetics of Politics in Time of Protest exhibition, which is running through August 1st. And we've been talking to a lot of the artists that are participating in the exhibition. Some of them couldn't make it because they're out of town or on assignment. They do work full time. Many of them do work full time as photojournalists in the real world. Not just in the gallery world. But with that, we're going to go back to Nicholas Brooks, Joey Melendez, and Brittany Davis. How you guys doing?
We're doing pretty good.
yeah, go ahead.
All right, so I think another thing, because of the gallery, we wanted to talk briefly on just how we decided to display our work in the gallery. Yeah. Let's pull up share screen.
Okay, so when we wanted to, I think it kind of started when I was talking to you, Rolando, about how I would go about displaying a video, the video of the protest that again was from a mixture from Coral Springs all the way to West Palm. So I wanted the experience to be for the viewer coming to the gallery to feel as if they're watching it from a familiar setting, which most familiar to us is the living room setting. It's a place where we all gather around of all ages, right? When you're a kid, you're watching TV in the living room, watching cartoons where you're learning. When you're a child, you're watching TV in the living room. When you're a teenager, an adult, you're watching TV in the living room. So for anybody who didn't get the experience to go out and actually be at the protest live, I wanted this to feel very familiar, which is the living room setting. With that theme, one thing that I believe we've all kind of felt amongst all the artists that we've talked about is that history does repeat itself. Back to the civil rights movement, now we're in 2020 and it's like history is repeating itself. The only difference is now we have a lot more unity in this movement than we might have back during the civil rights. So I wanted to set this in kind of a middle ground, which was the 90s feel. So I set up a 90s themed living room. With that, I have my video portion playing on one of those big box, super heavy televisions. There's a VHS that is being ejected, which is actually the title of the exhibit piece, which is Dear America, Are You Watching? And then on top of that, we have on the coffee table, the game of life, because this is something that is life. This is something we're experiencing. This is something that people are going through. It's not just made up, it's really happening. And that is why I have that representation on the board game. One of my best friends that actually lives in Boston, we were talking about the game of life when I told him I wanted to incorporate that into the installation. And he said, I actually love that board game. And I didn't think I mentioned this part, but he is a Black male in his 20s. So he said, I love this board game. Why? Because it was my first board game I loved as a kid, because from the very early age, I started equal to everybody else. And that kind of stuck with me, that the game of life, he felt equal to anybody else playing, regardless of the color of your skin. So I felt like that was really important to have on the coffee table, along with the newspapers that Sun Sentinel and do we remember this one? It was, yeah, New York Times posted about the different protests happening. There's a lot of meaning within this piece, right down to the photographs on the wall in the back. They're all people that I hold very near and dear to me. So there's a lot of symbolism within the piece. And I felt like it was very important for you as the viewer to feel like you're watching it in the living room. And then as you experience it in the living room, it then leads to their piece.
Yeah.
And we highly encourage everybody, if you're comfortable enough going to the gallery, because, you know, seeing it this way is totally different than actually being able to experience it firsthand. So if you're comfortable enough to make it to the gallery, definitely do. There are so many amazing pieces outside of this as well with the other artists too. So. But with,
with this one,
with any luck, we will have Brittany at the gallery to talk about the work, because she was there the other day and about five individuals came in and then like another three came in and she was so gracious. I mean, I didn't know that she was a photography person and then had her own photography studio. I would have sworn she worked at a museum as a docent. She was doing such a good job. I wanted to leave and leave her alone there. She was engaging everybody. It was wonderful.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, there, like everybody who's a part of this, like I just have to give everybody a shout out, because all of the amazing artists who were able to contribute to the gallery, it's just, it's amazing as an artist to be able to show off other artists and really be able to lift you guys up as well, because, you know, it's all about the community. Obviously, this is what this is all about. But yeah, so with our piece, I'll go ahead and let Nick start with that.
All right, so because we work so closely with Joey, we often try to have our pieces kind of like interact. Whereas his was more in the living room, we took the viewer inside the actual protest, and we wanted it to have three different layers. The first layer was the barricade, which you're supposed to move past or move through to break the barrier. We included metal like prints here that were a little bit more tension filled, even though I use the word tension filled, I mean, it was still so peaceful, but it had that more, that interaction with the police. And I found these like to be just like beautiful and of itself. And then the second layer, this was actually a photo before everything was fully set up. But the second layer with the mannequins, a male and female mannequin, has our statements, where these were, the only photos that were actually posed, as opposed to, or not necessarily posed, but like weren't in the moment, because like many of the other photographers and artists that spoke, we like to take the fly on the wall approach, but we saw these signs and we were just so captivated by the message that, you know, we wanted to actually capture that. And then they're framed by this photo in the middle that has a gentleman like touching the police. This was the Juneteenth. We can zoom in. it was actually on Juneteenth in the rain and everything. And I remember like I looked around and I saw this moment and I was just so captivated that I thought that this had a hopeful, almost optimistic message for the entire protest. And this is one of the images that I fell in love with. Yeah.
Well, thank you. I'm gonna move along right now and I'm gonna interject again for a minute and share my screen because we are missing one of the artists and he's been on text messaging me. He got caught up in traffic and Zoom doesn't let you connect unless you have an internet connection. So we're going to show a short little video and I'm going to share my screen now. And it's silent. We're going to be able to actually talk through it. And let me see how I could get this share. And this is actually Saul Martinez's work. And it's pretty short. I also have, this was, somebody could explain that's been there. Would you like to unmute yourselves if you were there?
I can speak on a couple of these photos. The first two photos were taken during the protest that went to the overpass of 95 and Southern Boulevard. This photo was taken right outside of the courthouse, has a ton of movement in it, which I think is absolutely beautiful. That's a picture of young Wiedmeyer, who's been the leader of the majority of the protests that have happened in West Palm Beach. I took a photo of him and I titled it The Peacemaker. He's a very peaceful young man who really advocates for justice and change peacefully. I don't know where that was taken, but it looks like you have a gentleman standing in front of the Highway State Patrol. Another one of Wiedmeyer again. 8 minutes and 46 seconds. Again, 8 minutes and 46 seconds. You had people laying down face first. People on the overpass of 95. An extremely emotional photo of someone yelling or cheering or chanting.
Okay, so if you're interested in seeing all of the videos that are included in the aesthetics of politics in time of protest,
issues related to COVID-19 staff.
Oh, there we go.
It's a number of meetings with CCA. We are meeting tomorrow to discuss.
What is that? I hear some other sound. What's going on?
Agreement on that. Both.
Does somebody have their mic on?
You're the only one.
A number of questions.
Yeah, it might be just hit the mute on the video or whatever's playing. Something might be playing on your computer.
Might have auto-played on YouTube.
Yeah.
In the background. Yep, you were right. I had to close out that window. Anyway, look for us on YouTube, the Box Gallery, and all the videos, including one by a Round Wellington editor, Krista, is shown. The full video that Zaragoza did, Jesus Zaragoza, is on there. A number of different videos, as well as compilations that were done by Reese. Reese, both of your films are there, the opening of the exhibition and the full version of your project. Do you want to show a little bit and talk to us why you chose the format that you did for the exhibition?
Sure. Yeah, so I wanted to, and I've always been enticed by the idea of a 360 or a tiny planet, you know, image from a 360 camera. And, you know, I bought the unit so that I could do 360 degree underwater time lapses. Had no intent on slapping it on my helmet and walking through, you know, a sea of people. But it, you know, as I did that, and as I was checking the video, and you know, I was just seeing that it, you know, I could be any person walking through, you know, these crowds. And you know, speaking of video, and I don't mean to bring this to a negative place, but I'd like to share some footage of Portland. This was from 2016, when Trump was elected, and there was this outcry for, you know, like, there's a reason, right? Like, why there was like public outcry as to his election. People were like literally sobbing in the streets, you know, like holding each other. And there's a reason. I mean, you know, like, people have been emboldened, you know, in his America. And well, I hate to say his America, really, it's our America. We should be taking that shit back. You know, so if you're okay with it, I would like to just show the juxtaposition between, you know, how the what the response has been, or what the response can be, whereas we've actually seen a relatively mild version of crowd control. And this is, you know, something that at the end of the video, and again, I'll wait for you, Rolando, to give me the green light.
Go ahead, go turn the video on. You could yeah. speak over it also.
It is basically, I was saved by a member of the media, and this is why we are important. This is why I'm sharing this video. This is why we collectively, those who document, we're imperative towards change, right? I was about to get mollywopped by some piggies who jumped off of a paddy wagon, and we're gonna, like, you know, loop us all up and, you know, throw us in the fish tank overnight. And this guy from K2 News literally grabs me by the nape of my neck and pulls me around the corner because he sees that I'm there, you know, stomach, you know, bound up. Wait, you know, this cop is, like, you know, coming to, like, assault us. So here, hold on, I'll share my screen. Is this it? Oh, I have to say that it can share my screen.
Andrea?
Everybody has access.
Click the little green button, share screen.
Oh, hang on. I have to leave the meeting. I'll be right back.
Okay. Well, while he does that, we are going to look a few more of Max Maldonado's pieces and have you share about your experience through the photos that you will be showing us.
Of course, of course. And I hopefully I got a better method of enlarging them for you guys to see them better. Gonna open it up now. There we go. How's that?
That is a little better, yeah. A
little better? All right. So I'll just minimally zoom in. How's that? Is that a little bit?
Yes.
Okay. So again, this is another one of the, this is one of the images from June 6th. This is the first, this is the second protest that I attended, but this is the first where I had attended where Wiedemeyer was the leader and the voice of, and the advocate of voice for everybody in the for everybody walking. So this part was the second road stop. We had been there was three road stops, I believe. 1, 2, 3. Either this is the second or the first. And this was at Belvedere, and this was a major moment of tension. This is where people were screaming obscenities at the officers in front of us. The officers were being trained to be stoic so that they didn't incite a charge from the other side with the protesters. This is also from the June 6th protests. I had been wandering around just trying to get my bearings at this point, and I just saw this moment of, you know, this, it pretty much sums up what this movement is about, of, you know, like, this is the future for the children. This is a future for, to, you know, to bring to light it's not that it hasn't been brought to light, but, you know, to really drive home the fact that, you know, we have a hand in helping, you know, push forward more rights, to push forward more change as well. Another image of, you know, of parents and children, so forth. More from June 6th. Oh, this is from the first protest that I attended. This is a little boy who had gone up on stage, and he was just being lowered down, and he had spoken about, you know, about trying to be, about being proud of being part of this change, of being part of this movement, Black Lives Matter movement. Let's see. Try and find some other images. This is one of the protesters. His name is Professor Tickering, Rudolph Tickering. He is a brilliant speaker, orator, and he has been almost at every other protest that I've been to past my second one. He is a very imposing presence, very tall man, very outspoken. He has this method of like commanding the crowd. And he's just got this amazing ability to rally and to speak. And him combined with Weedmeyer's efforts as well as other advocate efforts, it's just a mind-blowing experience to watch and to see this unfold before me. Some signs that I had gotten the moments in. Oh, this is another protester. Name is Paul. I forgot what his last name was, but he's also been very outspoken in these movements as well. Very well-known face at this point. But all in all, my main goal is to help document and to help, you know, push forward how this is changing, how South Florida as a place as well is changing, because Lake Worth was settled by historically a Black population. And over time, you know, as history rolled on, more and more groups got mixed in, but it's still historically a Black city. So I just wanted to also highlight that as well.
Well, thank you so much. Of course, I am going to intervene and I'm going to share my screen again to kind of catch up a little bit over here. Let's see, share. And I am going to show what Reese was talking about the 360 view. And this is from the first protest that was at Rosemary Square. And this is right at the beginning as people are starting to gather. And you see the little helmet that he has on? That is him. At this point, I think that he's holding, there is the camera. You can see it right on the helmet. And it kind of gives you an omnipotent point of view of what's going on. There's when I finally saw him there. And we got to take a couple of snapshots. Trying to keep my distance from everybody still at this point. But I'm going to go a little bit ahead. And here you see the true effect of the 360 viewpoint. And it feels like you're marching along with them. And I found this fascinating. When I saw the end result, it was amazing, and I knew it needed to be shown at the exhibition. So I called him and I asked him, do you have a still? And he goes, I didn't take any pictures. All I did was video. And I was like, well, grab me a still from the video. And he sent it along really quick, and the stills are just as magnificent as the video itself. And you're back. We were showing a few of your a few minutes of your video, but anyway, I'd like to thank everybody that's on you on Facebook, on the Box Gallery page, or on my profile, or on the very many other group pages that this has been shared to. I hope you're enjoying. These are the artists of In Time of Protest exhibition at the Box Gallery. And once again, you're just in time. So we're going to do our final rotation with all the artists, and we're going to get to see at least one or two more pictures, and cycle through the artists that are here. Kevin, you want to give it a go and, start us off?
Totally.
I'm very sorry to do so, but I do actually have to leave in a moment. Is it okay if I have that, queued up what I was intending?
Go ahead, by all means.
Pardon me, but I'll share this again. It just as a setup. This is from post-election 2016, and just as to show a juxtaposition as to the restraint that has been shown and you know, the coordination between government, law enforcement, and these protesters to an extent. Again, this is in Portland, Oregon, so I'll let it ride. So, yeah, basically, as you can see, it's, how do I unshare this?
go up on top and just click the little green bar and it'll close your screen.
Ah, there we go. Okay. So,
there you go.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and the music there was featured from the Dead Kennedys, and I felt like sharing that simply because, you know, and like I said at the end, you know, I was the shaking of the video that you see is of me, you know, being dragged away from it by another media member of the media, and you know, I see the same passion, I see the same amount of resolve for a lot of different issues, and you know, there's a lot of intersectionality in our society, and you know, there's something called stratification columns that have to deal with, you know, sexual orientation, race, you know, creed, socioeconomic standing, you know, your beliefs, your religious beliefs, and you know, that intersectionality is such a persistent and pervasive part of our lives that for an individual to not be an ally in some respect to another group, or for particularly white people and white men to not be allies, is to really make a statement saying that, you know, you're not only okay with the status quo, you are actively adding to that problem. So, you know, to see signs like white silence is white violence, you know, or white silence is white consent. Yeah, that is not only so true that, you know, it needs to be shouted from the rooftops, but it is that way for so many parts of our society. And I think that, you know, where you spend your money, you know, is supporting Black businesses. You know, you can, the only two voices that you really have are in your vote and in how you spend your capital. So, you know, and how you spend your time, I guess. So ultimately, you know, I do as much as I can to support Black businesses. You know, if you see a Black person getting pulled over, stop, even if nothing happens. You know, you have at least created the potential for accountability where there is so little in the society. So, yeah, being able to walk out the door and use the litany of privileges that are granted to me, you know, is probably the most powerful thing that I can do as a white man. And look, you know, that list of privileges are ones that I'm not even aware of, and that continued self-education and self-exploration and listening to others you know, I've learned so much about myself through hearing others and being like, well, damn, I guess I never really thought of it that way. Or, you know, I haven't heard that perspective before because I spent so much time, you know, curating the news that I was watching instead of, you know, kind of listening to as many voices as I possibly can. So listen to those voices, and know when to shut up too. So I'm going to shut up.
Thank you, Breeze. Talking about intersectionality, I am a mixed breed. I'm also gay, and I'm part of the elder community now. And it's challenging because people ask me, why do you show the work that you show? Why are you bringing some of these artists? They're not professional artists. Some of them are not professional artists or photojournalists. This is not what they do. This is, you know, have you turned pro-Black suddenly? Do you hate Trump? And pretty much this problem, it has nothing to do with Trump. Trump may have exasperated and pulled a veil off of the current climate that exists in this country that has existed. But I grew up with a Black grandmother, an Asian mother, and then I came out at 13. So it behooves me to support all social justice exhibitions. And I've held, this is not the first one. This just happens to be the first one that people are commenting on. So, because I've shown ecological works, commentaries on corporations, immigration shows, and nobody ever questioned it. But suddenly, because I am exhibiting work that deals with Black Lives Matter, people are challenging whether my gallery is changing or not. And no, it hasn't changed at all. It is a reflection of how I think, what my belief systems are, and what needs to be carried on to a specific market, which is the market that comes to my gallery, that would otherwise not go to the protests, would otherwise not engage in a conversation about social justice as it is seen through the Black community. And these things are important to me because hopefully it'll be a kickoff and a starting point for every community, the LGBT community, which is highly intersectional, because there's Blacks, there's Hispanics, there's Black Hispanics, there's every tone. One of the people that are not in this exhibition is Kevin Lawson, whose exhibition displayed issues of colorism within the same Black community. And instead of harping on the issue and the fallout of it, he celebrates it, which is what we should be doing. We are different. One of the most contentious things that I could hear is when someone that's dying to be an ally and is really committed to be an ally would get up and say things like, I don't see color. And that affects me deep because basically, once again, with the best intentions, they're making me invisible. I am brown. My friends are Black. They're Asian. They are of color, whether they're Native American, whether they're, you know, whatever, whether they're on the spectrum. They're non-binary, they're trans, they're whatever. Please see us. The idea, and I get the idea that I don't see color, and it means that they're impartial, that they don't separate people. But when you vocalize it that way, I feel like one of anybody, you know, I want you to see me. I want you to know my name. I want you to know that I'm brown. I want you to know that George Floyd was Black. I want you to know that he was murdered because of his color. I want you to see the color of his skin and realize that this exhibition is about people that have Black skin that are being killed, basically and well, only because of the color of their skin. And it happens every day. I lived for a while in Phoenix, Arizona. And in Phoenix, Arizona, it's the same case, but just because you're brown. Everybody that is brown skin is assumed to be an illegal immigrant and shaken down in public. And even if you have your paperwork, the police may take you in, get rid of your paperwork, because they're going to say, oh, it's probably fake anyway. You know, so this is a climate that's been going on here before Trump. And hopefully this will be a pivotal point in our history where we can address those issues. And I encourage everybody to come to the gallery and see these issues, to see the expressions that have been caught on the faces of the people that are outraged. And they're outraged because you do not understand, you do not take the time to understand, you do not sit and listen. I know that white fragility is something that comes up. And yes, you're very welcome to feel white fragility and to feel offended. But once that passes, stop. I know that the initial reaction is to be defensive about certain things, to say blue lives matter, to say white lives matter, to say all lives matter. And I get that that's a knee-jerk reaction. And get to sit with that comment and look at that comment and enjoy it and embrace it, because that's how you feel. And you're not wrong for feeling that way. I don't want to make you wrong, but I want you to sit down and consider why right now this movement is called Black Lives Matter. And it's not the organization. So don't pick on nuances of the Black Lives Matter organization to discredit it. It is your neighbor. It is your son, your daughter's schoolmate. It is their parents that are going through something that you will not have an idea what it's like. So sit with the kids. Sit with the parents, sit with the artists, sit with the protesters, give them 5 damn minutes of your time and find out what it is that they really feel. I have been really impressed just talking to some of the young kids, how focused and how clearly they can explain how they were raised and in the fear that they grew up, that even walking to school, they had to look both ways, no matter where they were. When a cop rolls in, they know that they're there to do something to them. They don't feel that they're being protected. And that needs to end up in the conversations. How can that change? I don't think that people understand when they mean defund the police, they mean reallocate funds, learn that you don't gather people, you don't pass judgment on a crowd of people just because of the neighborhood or the statistics of the crime that they live in, that they're human beings, and that yes, maybe it's a high crime area, but that does not mean that everybody in that area is a criminal. And they have the right to be judged by a jury, not on the street. You know, many of these people are being judged, convicted, and killed on the street for simply being in a high crime rate area where people assume the worst. And that's what I've understood when I've sat there and talked to a lot of these people, whether they are white or brown or black, in any high crime area, this is typical. But primarily, it's been out of hand in the black community. And it's more often than not vented at black men. And that's why this whole movement is here. And if you could save and pass a law that could save one black man's life, you might save a brown man's life or a gay man's life or a trans life. We have the highest incidence as in Florida of black trans women being killed, being murdered, and nobody seems to care. Black trans women are about as disposable as gay and lesbian and men were during the peak of the AIDS pandemic. And we need to look at all black lives because they're being victimized because of the color of their skin. And we're all finally going to give, oh, he tuned out. So we're back to Zach.
Could I finish before?
Yeah, there you
are. Wait, was I gone?
Yeah, for a minute there, you went off my screen.
Oh, okay. Well, I guess this kind of follows Reese's video well, and let's get back to, lost my place there. All right. So yeah, how I said earlier, got to remember, not all cops, you know, are villainous. Yeah, about that. This dude right here, T. Cole, you can see the kind of malice in his face. He was grimacing at everyone that passed by, and you can kind of just, it's extremely visible, the vitriol he just wants to unleash upon everyone. It's important to know there are some villainous looking individuals like this one who made sure to try to intimidate everyone the best he could. He was just eyeing everyone down. And I made sure I got to capture individuals like that as well. June 13th, like Zach was showing. And this is when we were met with the police blockade on Buena Vida, I believe it is, Buena Vida and Olympia. Yeah, we were there for 10 plus hours. And here you can see no name tags, no body cams. Whoops. Sorry about that. No name tags, no body cams. She brought her own GoPro though, so I guess there's that, right? But yeah, it's important to know. And on this background right here, same date. I want to
mention something about that. Just an experience that I experienced and want to share. It was the first protest, so it was when this whole like cops and citizens thing was very new to everyone, and there was a young girl who like quickly took a selfie of her and a police officer behind her, and the police officer looked at her and said, you know, I would have smiled with you or posed for the picture. And she's like, really? And the fact that she was so shocked that the police officer would actually smile and be nice said a lot to me. Like, she was so shocked that they would even smile or take the time to take a photo, and it shouldn't be like that. I just thought that was crazy. Sorry, Kevin, I just had to interrupt and just tell that story.
You're good. I mean, I think, yeah, kind of is a testament to this massive schism, this ever-widening schism between the people and our public servants, you know, one of the biggest gangs, aka the Boys in Blue. I guess the boys in green in this case. Well, boys and girls, of course.
Well, Kevin, if I can say something real quick, you know, too, and sorry to also jump in on your deal again, but it just sure, when I see this, like, in this guy who was so upset, T. Cole, first off, this violates like their him not having his name badge displayed. It's a violation.
T. Cole does.
This other fellow, but it, I just want to, I don't know if the Blue Lives Matter piece has been touched on yet or not, but I want to explain why that's absolute horseshit. And it's because you choose to put that uniform on. You choose to be part of a system that is designed to chew up and spit out people like they're fucking meat. And at the end of the day, you go home and you take that uniform off. Well, Black people, brown people, you know, other people of color, other marginalized groups, they don't get to take that skin off when they get home. They don't get to, you know, take that uniform off and go out in public and parade as if they aren't part of one of the greatest oppressive forces that has ever been known in the history of man. So, do blue lives matter? Sorry, not in this man's opinion. So,
they're not born blue.
Right, they're not born blue.
So, yeah, I mean, they are wearing the uniform and donning on responsibilities, but many of them, unfortunately, are of a sociopathic ilk, and there needs to be change. So, I mean, case in point about this is just the lack of culpability, the lack of, you know, any kind of identification, and this was widespread throughout the whole...
I'm going to interject here. Okay.
Okay.
Yes. We know that there are horrible human beings that take advantage of their uniform. We know that the system protects them. We also have family members that wear blue. We have brothers, we have sisters, we have people in the forces that are there, that are good people, that want to protect and serve. And they're caught right now in a crossfire, because if they speak up, they are getting the short end of the stick from all of their, and they're outcasted from their only employment, okay? And it's very easy to say quit when this is the, they have a family and this is their only source of income. And maybe it's been generational in their family, but they are good. And we need to acknowledge those people for doing a wonderful job, just like our chief of police and chief of fire departments, because they wake up every morning not knowing if they're coming back home also, oh, right?
And sure, but so do firefighters, but nobody's saying, you know, defund the fire department. People
that feel compromised through this whole thing. And I know one woman that quit the force because of attacks to her, you know? And I get the non-solution-based defund and get rid of the police, but until we have an alternative solution, we need to meet at the table and find out how best we can resolve a lot of these issues until we either establish a charter law public service force like we do with charter schools, and we could have both and choose which one we want to protect our areas. There's a number of ideas that have worked throughout the country, but through the process, we need to make sure that we don't damage the few good people and have them quit when we need them on the force.
Thank you for that, Rolando.
That's my opinion.
Yeah, thank you. No, thank you for saying it, you know, because
it is
Keith. And oh, that's my dog barking. Sorry about that, if you can hear that. Yeah, no, it's important to know that, of course, you know, as showcased in my image of the officer in the rain, you know, I don't believe in blanket generalizations. I have a friend who's Riviera PD, and he's a good guy. So in these instances, though, these officers lacking identification and badge numbers, I believe it was an egregious miscarriage of their responsibilities as public defenders, you know, public servants. It just kind of, it was like in a show of intimidation or something. But here we have a protester. She is showcasing a sign that has statistics of citizens killed by police in 2019. And Denmark 0, Switzerland 0, and it goes to an astronomical number to the United States. And this showcases the rage, you know, the anger, the passion. She has a chance now to speak and scream, and it's just kind of parallel, like in the background, and the background right here, and the background behind her, there's just an army of officers, a ludicrous amount of officers. I don't know if you can see in the background, but the line extended from all the way past the screen, past the ratio of the screen. So, you know, it was quite a bold moment, I imagine. It had to have been huge to just kind of scream with everything in your heart against an army of officers behind you. And that very night, as you can see right here, Antonio, Mr. Antonio right here, saw this gentleman across the street, Trump shirt, waving his big old flag across the street. And he was kind of at it for a couple hours. We've been at it for a couple hours. Antonio calls upon him. He says, hey, why don't you come on over, man? We got food. You got to be hungry. You got to be thirsty. You know, even though you got that dumbass shirt on, come on over, is what he said. Sorry if that's a bad language. But yeah, he's like, come on, man, just come across the street. We'll feed you. We'll give you water. And it was a moment just to show that this is peaceful. This is a moment of unity. We care about making sure that there's a dialogue and conversation, and just to show that we're here to be peaceful. And that guy came across the street and he said, I'll be honest, I didn't think that you guys would be, you know, this cool. I didn't think you guys would be this nice. I didn't think you'd give me a chance to speak. So this kind of goes to show, like, Wedmeyer, Antonio, you know, everyone, Bryce right here in the foreground, everyone was just willing, like, come on, let's just have this conversation. You can speak your piece, we'll speak our piece, we'll give you a sandwich, have some water, and we'll go better ways. And you're gonna know, and you're gonna tell everybody, hey, we're peaceful, we don't want any trouble. We're here for a good cause. I thought that was important. And this is Crystal, aka Clementine. And this is just kind of, I shot this just to kind of depict the importance of like morale, people on the outside being able to stop in their cars because there was a little traffic jam from when we marched across, what bridge was that? This was on Congress, I think. And she's waving her fist in the air, screaming, giving everyone like a morale boost. And everyone, there was a line of cars of people all showing support. And I thought that's just a great thing from people on the outside in their cars, walking across the street, just to show some morale, show some support. It lets everyone know that, hey, like it's not just in the group or felt. There's people coming around, you know, from the outside, driving up, pulling up, that are showing support. And yeah, I just close with this image. This is the last image I got on my slideshow, just kind of showing, you know, the Black Lives Matter movement. I can't breathe. It's a flag, you know, right here, kind of in contrast with the state of Florida flag and the United States flag behind it, showing that this is, you know, a nationwide movement. This is a national thing, international actually. And you know, we got all eyes here, we got all attention focusing on it, including this police officer in the background over there. I don't know if you can see him, this dude right here. All eyes on this movement, all eyes are focusing on it, and thankfully it's getting some national, international attention. And we as photographers, we as artists, we all play a part in making sure that we capture the moments, we immortalize the moments, we spread the moments. So people are continuously knowing that, like, you know, they're being immortalized in the annals of history. And it's a good thing. And no matter what role we play or no matter what sacrifices we make, because you know, I've made sacrifices to do this too. Some of you know, but I feel like, you know, it's important to just make some kind of sacrifices. Like I lost my apprenticeship and my job just simply capturing the protests. And you always got to just know in your heart when there's something that you got to do, when there's something that you got to play a part in. If you can do anything, if it's in your heart, you know that's the right thing to do, you should do it. Absolutely do it. You know, the fruits will spawn thereafter, but you know, it's just critical to play your part. And I think that's all I got to say.
Thank you, Kevin. And let's go to Zach.
I just want to share a couple more photos with you guys. Just a couple more photos that I feel speak to the movement and everything that's happened. But one thing I want to say that's kind of funny and ironic and all this is that all of us photographers and videographers have pretty much covered the same exact events. So all of our photos have very similar subject matter to them in terms of people and things like that, but it's kind of different to see everyone in through everyone's different lenses. But with that being said, there's so many like true like leaders and players in this organization that it's so hard not to capture those same people. So with that being said, I want to start off by showing you guys a picture of Weedmire, who you've seen a few different times now throughout this little Zoom meeting. And this is a piece that is actually on display at the gallery. And I titled it The Peacemaker because he is definitely the peacemaker of the entire group. Recently, we've kind of seen two subgroups emerge from our original protest group. We've seen more of like a radical type group, and then we've seen more of like this peaceful type group. And Weedmire has stuck to his guns in terms of being peaceful. He was challenged one protest to go over to Mar-a-Lago and march over to Mar-a-Lago and make a big scene. And he respectfully declined because he was afraid, for lack of a better term. And he didn't want to start any violence or any ill feelings toward the police. And that's actually where this was taken, was right before we decided, or he decided, whether or not he was going to go over to the over the bridge to Mar-a-Lago.
Whoops. Thank you, Zach.
I'll show you guys a couple more. Sorry, my screen just stopped sharing.
Alrighty.
One second. This is a photo that I took of a young woman standing in front of a line of police officers that are blocking the bridge to go over to Palm Beach Island, which I thought was really ironic because they let us march wherever we wanted to in downtown West Palm. But as soon as we wanted to go over to the rich part of town or Palm Beach Island, that was not acceptable. So they stopped us here. And this lady asked if I would take her photo in front of the line of police holding the Black Woman Matter sign. And I feel like that sign was really important for me to capture because you see so many signs of the Black Lives Matter and those types of signs, but very little of Black Women Matter or Trans Lives Matter or things like that. So I thought that this was really important to capture. And then next is of another woman marching through the streets of, I think that was on Australian Boulevard or something like that. But it was one of the protests where we were actually able to have the street closed down for us. The cops were extremely helpful in guiding us and making sure that we had a clear path and a clear route to march on. But this picture I think is just so strong and powerful, like with her hand up and wide open like this and just how big she is in the frame, you can really kind of get the sense of her emotion and her power. And then her queen shirt, I think, really pops out, and she really does look like a queen in this photo. And lastly, I have another photo taken on the overpass of Southern Boulevard, I believe. And it's just of two gentlemen standing across from each other. You have a Black gentleman standing in front of a police officer holding a sign. And you can just tell by the expression on the police officer that he just does not want to hear it at all. He already has a response and a rebuttal that he's ready to come out with. Doesn't even matter what this gentleman is saying or what his sign says or anything like that. And you can just kind of see, again, the use of excessive force that the police were threatening us with these zip ties for handcuffs and the riot gear and everything like that. And I just thought, like, even though it was a very stressful moment, just these two people standing together really told a really important story. So that's all I have for my images.
Miss Nelson again. Do you have another picture that you want to share with us?
I'm just gonna show one more. So I wanted to show this photo mainly for the sign that says we broke the social contract, white America. So, and also just my other photos that if like you can swipe through really quickly, I was just, you know, impressed by everyone, the groups of people from everywhere that came, that are coming together for this movement. And just to really just like plug a couple of resources or just to urge people to educate themselves on what's going on. So everyone's images that you've been seeing tonight is evidence of what is going on. So if you ever had any doubt in your mind before of whether or not this was just, you know, the media or propaganda or whatever you may believe, like we are all have given you like evidence of that this is a very real, very serious issue that did not go away when Obama was elected into office, but is a still very, very serious, very real thing in America, which is racism. And I urge you, this sign, the social contract, she is referencing a Trevor Noah video. So you can easily go on YouTube and type in Trevor Noah social contract, watch that video of what he has to say, and then watch a video on Kimberly Jones and her commentary on that video of how can we win? How can we win when the systems that are supposed to protect us and put in place to protect us have failed us? How can we win? And talk about how that social contract is being broken. And you can easily Google anything. There's documentaries on Netflix from 13th to I'm Not Your Negro. There's so many resources out there. So I'm just, you know, using my time now to urge you guys to educate yourselves. The resources are there. Have those tough conversations with your friends that are people of color, and even have those very uncomfortable conversations with your family. about race and privilege and all the things that are happening now. And we are living in a very, very special, very fragile time right now. And we all have the chance and opportunity to make a difference and change this world. So I urge everyone to take that opportunity to educate themselves and to be the change that they want to see.
Thank you. I am going to share my screen a little bit. We talk about, there was a, on one of the protests that was going on, there was an interview, and we're gonna talk about it because it comes up all the time, where they were saying that there were people from Antifa, as if Antifa were a group. And to clarify that Antifa is not a group, it is a mindset, it is a belief system that individuals have, individuals who may be one in a group, maybe two people, they have a belief system. And it was so funny because he happened to be a black man. He goes like this, I have a lot of white friends that are Antifa that also believe just like me. And it's important for the Black Lives Matter movement and for the white allies in the Black Lives Matter movement to understand why we have friends that are from all different races and all different belief systems. And it's because of access. We each have access to a particular group where one person may not be allowed in, another person can. And where one person can speak comfortably to an audience, another person may not be. I would probably have a Baptist go talk to a Baptist preacher if I wanted the Baptist preacher to say something that favors a particular cause or event that I'm putting together. If I wanted to do something about Judaism, I would talk to a rabbi, or I would go to the Jewish Federation and have them talk to their constituents. They would be much easier to enroll that way. As an ally, I have a gallery, which I could use to personify and amplify the voices through visual arts. I also have a lot of media contacts. And from the first event that I went, this is what I didn't bother to send anything to my friends in the press. The second time I did, and that's when I started reaching out to all of you artists to collect your work, because what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to also not just create an exhibition, but an archive, a historical archive with dates separated by the days of the protest, so that we could keep an archive. And quite possibly I am going to be speaking to a couple of the historic museums to see if they will, if I work on it and I catalog it all, if they will hold it for posterity, because that also costs money and storage and stuff like that. But this may be an easy sell because most of it is digital. So it wouldn't take so much room. But with that, I want to show you one of my images that did make the news because of, and I was happy because it did question all of us. And it's here, and I have no idea who this young man is. And if you do know, please send him my way so I could thank him personally for having a wonderful sign. And it says, if you ever wondered what you'd be doing during slavery, the Holocaust, or the civil rights movement, you're doing it right now. And it's a mirror so that you could look at yourself, and either you are sitting at home doing absolutely nothing on Facebook, judging everybody, castigating everybody, creating little things to nitpick about, trying your hardest to deviate the conversation and to derail it into other things, to the looting, to the this, to that, and trying to ignore the core issue of the problem. Or you're there participating in the change. And it's just a moment for you to look at yourself in the mirror and reflect. Maldonado, talk to us. What else do you have for us?
Okay, so when everybody was going on about the police and everything like that, and you know how it's, how during these times it's hard not to look at them as the enemy, I just wanted to highlight a few images that I have captured. I hadn't gotten the chance to really work on them, but I wanted to show you, like, you know, there is humanity in this time of, in this time of extreme, in the, like, this time of chaos, especially. At this point in the protest, this is back at June 6th again. Oh, sorry, I forgot to share the screen. Give me one second. All right. Sorry about that. This is back in, so again, I keep referencing these photos from June 6th because this was at a time when it was just still fresh, the pain of the pain of George Floyd's death. This is very point where it was more raw than it was tempered, and emotions were flying very high. And this young activist, I forgot to capture her name. I have to find out it sooner.
Venetia Pierre.
Venetia Pierre? Okay. Venetia Pierre, and she was in part with Wiedemeyer's movement. And Kevin, is Venetia related to Wiedemeyer? Because it sounds like Pierre Wiedemeyer.
It is a common last name, but I'm not entirely sure because I think he said this is my sister.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm not entirely sure, but
okay, it might have just been a sign of camaraderie or something. But
yeah.
In any case, she had gotten into this emotionally charged argument with this one officer in front of her. He had said nothing, but she had noticed a chink in his armor in terms of just his emotions. And throughout the entire time, she kept saying, "I see you, I see you, I see your humanity." And as a response, he actually lowered his shield and showed that he was crying, that tears were streaming down his eyes. You can't really see them in these images, if I had dropped the shadows a little bit, but in these images, he had tears streaming down his eyes. This is a moment of extreme emotion, as this is the point where we were bottlenecked at the Club Ultra, and we were in an extreme point of tension between the two sides. So I just wanted to pull these images up to show you that this is, that, you know, there is two sides to the same story, that, you know, there are, like, that this, that at these moments, there are extreme, that there are points of humanity that are sprinkled in beneath, in between them. But unfortunately, like I said, at this moment, it is very easy to see the ones that are supposed to protect us as the enemy. And so I just wanted to show you that not all, you know, and it's not that it's not obvious that all cops are evil, but at this point, you know, there are some that are just lost in the fray of, you know, the negative press and so forth, and that they are, that there are good people in the ranks.
Thank you. And I think we've gone through everybody. And Brittany, have you ever spoken? Would you like to say anything in closing?
Oh, goodness. Wow. Don't put me on the spot or anything now, Rolando.
You've been there playing with your dog all this time.
God, I'm so sorry about that.
I've been watching you. So has everybody on Facebook.
No, I was trying. I have this really bad problem where once, like, I get uncontrollable laughter if the smallest thing, and it's just, I know, so inappropriate. I'm so sorry.
No, I've been eating, drinking soda, smoking cigarettes. I've been doing everything.
I thought you said casual. I'm just kidding. No, but just, I guess in closing, I would just like to say, you know, again, to all of the artists, those who are here on this forum tonight, and those who couldn't make it, and those who may not even be part of the Box Gallery exhibition, but who are out there documenting, you know, being able to to be the voices for those who can't be, and especially, you know, being able to be an ally as part of the movement. And, you know, one of the biggest things with mine and Nick's business, Brooks and Davis Photography, that we're very proud of, and it's one of the things kind of going back to what you and Miss Nelson were saying as far as, you know, for those, there's sometimes where, you know, when my white privilege can come in, then I can go ahead and I can speak up. And then there's some moments like now where we really need to be able to put Nick front and center, because this is something that's obviously near and dear to him and hitting at a different level. Yeah. So because we are an interracially owned business and our friendship is so, you know, tight knit, and, you know, and just even in our immediate friend groups, like it is very diverse. And so having those open conversations, being able to break down those barriers and start talking about the things that are very uncomfortable to talk about, and learning something new by being able to share those experiences. And then talking not only to the people, you know, I believe that we were talking about this at one of the times that we were all together in this in the exhibition, but not only talking to those people who share the same point of views as you, but starting to open up those conversations with people who maybe don't. And maybe by having these pieces in the show, and we thank you so, so much for giving us the opportunity to showcase this, by being able to do that, hopefully maybe we'll be able to change one person's mind or open their eyes to something maybe they had no idea on that perspective. So that's what I would say in closing.
Thank you. If we could change one mind in 1 month long show, if I could do that, and if each one of us could change one mind a month just to listen, we would have a whole paradigm shift in this country, you know? So, I come up with the ideas, I bring the people together, but I don't do it alone. Neither is this Facebook done, this Facebook live presentation or Zoom is not done alone. It is done with a volunteer and a gracious intern, which we've all got to meet. So I want to give Andrea Luce a big round of applause. Andrea, how you doing? And believe it or not, a lot of the press releases were information that were sent out to the press were bits and pieces of an essay that we will be publishing that Andrea wrote in regards to the show. We've delayed it a little bit so she gets to know you a little bit more, and she got to see the work, but she began the essay before the exhibition started. Oh, by the way, I love that t-shirt that you're wearing there, darling. Ah, I just noticed it. Anyway, Andrea, thank you so much. Tomorrow is Thursday. Andrea will be at the gallery welcoming everybody and all our guests that want to come and see the show. You're welcome to call me at 786-521-1199 to set up an appointment if you can't be at the gallery between 12 and 4 p.m. I live a block away, and I'd be delighted at any time in the evening or even late at night to open up for you to come in and see it. If anybody feels more comfortable by themselves, I could arrange that. We do require that you have a mask. If you don't have a mask, one will be provided for you. I'm stocked up so that you feel safe, I feel safe, and that we remain a non-statistic in association with Black Lives Matters. Black Lives Matter movement has proven that by wearing a mask and in the protests and maintaining even in tight groups, that the spread of COVID is minimized quite a bit. So it does work. If not, we would have a lot of sick young millennials, and we don't. But anyway, with that said, I'd like to thank everybody on Facebook Live that's watched us. Thank you so much. I'd like to thank all of the artists for participating and doing a great job of documenting a wonderful movement. And I encourage anybody else that has been taking video or photographs to contact the Box Gallery at Palm Beach Fine Art Gallery curatedpodcast@gmail.com and let me know who you are so that I can incorporate you into the show in some manner. And as Zach very clearly pointed out, make art, not war. And what is the wonderful, wonderful slogan that you have for your installation? That you even printed up a t-shirt that I hope you print more of them so that we can buy one.
So my installation was called Rise Up, Come Together. And that is exactly what we need to do as a community. We need to rise up, continue to rise up, continue to come together. Remember that we're working in fighting for the same outcome, and that if we work together, anything is possible.
And that's a freebie for all you fish heads, because that's a line from a fish song. Anyway, God bless you all. Have a nice evening. Thank you all for coming. Say goodbye to everybody on Facebook.